Well, let's stand together again, shall we? We're going to have a little bit of exercise here and kind of keep things moving along. If you would stand and turn back to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. And we're going to read tonight beginning in verse number 13 as we move right into the message time. And let's look at Romans chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. I'd like to preach tonight on the subject, the characteristics of the unashamed. God has commanded us not to be ashamed of the gospel. What does that look like in our everyday life? And in Romans chapter 1 and verse number 13, we'll begin our reading tonight, and then we'll get into this message. Romans 1, 13. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oft times I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Father, we know that the new year is more than a banner or a slogan. We know that this is an opportunity where each of us might grow in knowledge and grow in faith. And I ask that you would help us tonight to take that step of growth, that we would never be ashamed of you or your gospel. Keep us in tune, Lord, to the truths of your word tonight, for I pray and ask this in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, there is no question the Apostle Paul had a great burden for the city of Rome. In fact, he would have written this epistle before his first trip to Rome, and he very explicitly tells the Romans of his desire to be with them. In fact, he is clearly telling them that as much as in him, really as much as he had or could express, he wanted to come and to be with them in this Roman capital, the capital, many would say, of the entire world. By Paul's time and this particular period of world history, the city of Rome had at least 1 million people, maybe 2 or 3 million people that gathered in the environs around Rome. And Rome attracted people from all over the empire. In fact, so many people that they brought various different religions, and in fact, so many different religions that they literally established and built an amazing, amazing edifice known as the Pantheon. It was the God House. And you can see this even in modern day Rome as you visit the Pantheon, and you'll be able to see the various porticos where different deities and idols were placed. And this was the Romans' way of showing a multicultural type of welcome to all who would come in. We've got a God for you. We have all of the various gods in this God house. And Paul was so burdened about this. He wanted them to know the true and the living God, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the Apostle Paul, as he prepares to come to the Romans, he reminds them of the supremacy of the gospel over the paganism of Rome. He was not ashamed of the gospel, he said. He gloried in the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:31 that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. There is no person, there is no church, there is no football team, there is no organization that is worthy of our adoration other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And this was the message of Paul. I want to come to you at Rome and remind you of something so much greater, and introduce you to someone so much greater than any god you have ever brought to this city. And so it was. Paul established himself as a man unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, there are some characteristics about this man's life that I would like our church to adopt, that I would like to set forth as goals spiritually tonight. The first characteristic of an unashamed Christian is that he or she lives with a holy purpose in life. They live with a purpose from the Word of God. We see the purpose in verse 13. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oft times I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as other Gentiles. Now, we see a planned purpose. The very word purpose means to set before oneself. So Paul, though he had many places he could go and many things he could do, he set before himself a purpose. And he purposed, much like Brother Whipler on his way to Finland. This has been a purpose in his life the last several years. Paul had purposed in his heart that he might come to Rome. The Bible says in Philippians 3 and 13, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." He was a man with a spiritual purpose. He was constantly pressing toward the mark of Christ, pressing toward the will of God in his life. We see a planned purpose. May I challenge you tonight to have a purpose that is spiritual in nature. It is wonderful to have goals, and I have many personal goals and goals that relate to family and goals that relate to perhaps things that we would consider less in the sense of importance, maybe some things I'd like to do for my wife and so forth, not less important for her, but I'm simply saying there ought to be in the goal list some things that you have that are of a higher spiritual nature from the standpoint of being greatly used of God, and this was Paul's purpose. There were many other purposes, no doubt, many other plans in his life, but he purposed in his heart to get to Rome, this needy city. It was a planned purpose, but I also see it was a fruitful purpose, a fruitful purpose. And I want you to notice that in verse 13, he says, "that I might have some fruit among you also." Would you say that phrase with me? "That I might have some fruit among you also." How many of you would like to have some fruit this year? This was his purpose. He was purposing that he might have fruit, meaning the souls of men. "Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall they be my disciples." His desire was the souls of men. His desire was the establishment of a church, a group of people who would be discipled around the great doctrines of the Word of God. Notice that in verse 11. "For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established." The word "established" meaning to place firmly, to strengthen. He realized that he may not live his entire life in Rome. He may not be there for many, many years. But if he could bear fruit and if he could establish them and leave a church, he could leave something that would make an impact for a long, long time. We pray that Brother Whipler will stay in Finland for many, many years. But in the event that God allows him there only for a short time, it is his desire that there would be souls saved and discipled and established so that the work of God always goes on. This was the heart of the Apostle Paul. It was a heart of purpose. And tonight as we gather here, we are purposing as a church. We are covenanting together that God would help us to more further establish his work spiritually, that we would be working and laboring together with the purpose of heaven in our mind. Tonight I want to share with you some of the purposes of our church and some things that are of great importance. And I call your attention to the book tonight that we have placed in your hand. And you'll notice as you open the book several things that we'll not take the time to review. You'll notice on page 4, the core values of the church. On page 6, the ministry path of the church. And I'm going to ask the church to read this 95-page booklet over the next few weeks and maybe take a day and study the scriptures related to the purpose and to the path. You're going to find some new ministries. I'll be mentioning some of these prayer opportunities in just a moment. You'll see the soul-winning schedule. You'll see the upcoming sermons on page 13, where we're going biblically in the preaching. You'll notice some great calendar events here related to the building. We'll come back to some of that as well. You'll see the adult Bible class connection groups there. And then if you would, turn over in the booklet here, all the way to page number 22. And you're going to find here some of the ministry goals of Lancaster Baptist Church. And this is the night where we share some of the goals and some of the vision. And I'll try to come through this from the standpoint of somewhat of an order. You may have to jump ahead here and there to follow along with me. But I want to share tonight some of the vision and purpose that God has laid upon my heart for Lancaster Baptist Church. The first thing that I want to share with you, and it may not be in this order in the booklet, it's earlier mentioned, that is the ministry of prayer. It's my heart's desire that in this year our church would become a greater church of prayer. A people who gather in the particular page that deals with the prayer times. We're going to be moving the men's prayer to 8:45 on Saturday morning. We're going to share a brief time of scripture. We're going to learn how to pray according to that scripture. We're going to begin something new this year called pre-service prayer. That prayer meeting will take place starting next Sunday at 7:45 for any man, woman, boy, or girl who wants to come before the service and just pray that God would bless the service. We're going to be having a few people pray during the services, and they're going to be praying in a special place and asking God to help pastor while he preaches and asking God to help the choir while they sing. There'll be several new emphasis on prayer that you'll be hearing about and seeing even in the booklet. But I think perhaps the most significant start spiritually regarding Bible reading and prayer is found in this booklet as you turn, please, to page number 42. And I know we're going to talk about some numerical goals and things like this, but I'd like to share with you tonight just spiritually where I'd like you to begin. And if you get nothing else as I cover the goals, I'd like you to hear me for the next 5 minutes tonight. There's a note here on page 42 that I'd like you to read as you have opportunity. On the first part of it, it says, "Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded." This is a year to draw nigh to the Lord. Tonight, I'm asking our church family to join me on a 40-day journey or walk with God, a journey of Bible study and prayer. Now, this will require scheduling some time and having some dedication, and we're going to use an acronym this year that we've never used before at Lancaster Baptist Church. So I want you to notice it is the word SOAP, and you'll see those four words. Let's read them together there at the top of page 43. Ready? Begin. Scripture, observation, application, prayer. Now the Bible says, "Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word." Now here's how this acronym will work in our personal lives every morning as we get together with the Lord. First, we're going to read the scripture that is assigned. I'll show you how that'll work in a moment. Very simply begin with reading a chapter of the Word of God. Secondly, as a part of this reading the scripture, we're going to write out at least one verse from the reading. That's what the word scripture will lead us to do. To read a chapter, to write a verse. How many of you are with me so far? All right, not too hard. Read a chapter, write a verse. The letter O is for the word observation. From that verse, we're going to ask every one of you to write out an observation about what that verse meant. What did that verse say to you? Something that you observed from the Word of God. Thirdly is the letter A. This is for application. We're going to write down what we can apply from that verse to our life. We're going to write down an application. This is something a fourth grader can do. This is something that someone who's been saved 40 years can do. Everybody can write down an application. And then the letter P stands for the word prayer. Now, at this point, we're going to do something as a church that I'll be doing with the men on Saturday mornings. We're going to turn the application into a prayer. In essence, we're going to pray that verse. We're going to pray according to what the verse said to us. So let's take an example for this, okay? Turn to page 44. The Bible says here, the booklet says here in Romans chapter 6, we will read the entire chapter. Romans chapter 6. We will write a verse from Romans 6. We have written here Romans 6:18. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. There's the one verse. By the way, how many of you would say, that's a great verse to live by? Amen? Being freed from sin and being a servant of righteousness. So the observation is, not only does God's grace make Christians free from the bondage of sin, but it gives us power to become the servants of righteousness, all right? By the grace of God, we're free from sin. We're servants of righteousness. That's the observation. Now we have to write the application. This is where we let the Holy Spirit preach the sermon directly to us on a Tuesday morning over some coffee or whatever. Here's the application. I have God's power today to say no to sin and instead to serve God. That would be the observation there, that, or the application that we could make. God will give me the power to overcome sin and to serve Him. And then here's the prayer. Lord, thank you for freeing me from the bondage of sin. Help me today to proactively obey and serve you. And there you have it, SOAP, all right? So let's go through SOAP once again. The letter S stands for what? Help me out, stands for what? We're going to read a chapter. The letter O stands for? There's going to be a verse, there'll probably be more than one, but there's going to be one that just smacks you right between the eyes, and I want to encourage you to write the verse out. How many of you are like me? The older you get, the harder it is to memorize verses. Come on. And I don't know. The last few weeks, I wrote out several chapters of the Bible, and sometimes I find myself needing to slow down and really meditate so I can really get the meaning. And that's why we're going to pick one verse that we're going to write. Then we have the letter A, which stands for? And that's where I write out what God said to me from that chapter. And then letter P stands for? And the prayer must be in accordance with what God said to you. You're going to pray that principle, and you're going to pray it to the Lord. And I just believe that if all of us in this room would take this simple journey for the next 40 days, it could be revolutionary in the life of the Lancaster Baptist Church. And we've taken some time to put this together. Please do not leave it laying around. Put it where you'll not forget it, and take time with God. Now, beyond this matter of prayer at the church, prayer before the services, beyond the matter of personal time with the Lord, I also tonight want to encourage many of you to consider the next 40 days to enhance your prayer life with some form of fasting. Fasting is the denial of self in order that we might say, God, nothing matters more to me than you, or having this prayer answered, or knowing you in a greater way. Now, I do not have time to preach an entire message. I have written a lesson on the subject of fasting. Let me give you some suggestions on some type of fast that you may choose. I don't expect that anybody here will go on a 40-day fast of no food. I only have one friend that ever did that. Brother Doug Fisher went on a 40-day fast. I don't know how he did it. I don't know how he lived through it. I saw him on the 38th day, and it was amazing, actually. So I'm not advocating that. In fact, I'm not going to advocate that you do any prolonged fast, three meals a day, missing three meals a day, without speaking to your doctor, okay? So be careful about fasting. But let's look at some fasts that I think are very appropriately applied and immediately so. Now, some may want to take one day a week for a full day fast. You may say, I'm going to fast on Thursdays. I'll drink water or juice, but that's what I'm going to do on one day a week. Some might take a partial day. You might say, I'm going to miss lunch on this day of the week, and that's what I'm going to spend extra time talking to God in my prayer life. Some may miss just one meal. Some might say, I will eat no dessert in the month of January and February. Some might go on a coffee or soda fast. And I know for some of you, that's like withdrawals, right? But that may be a fast that someone here, the Lord, puts it on your heart to make. Many of us may need to go on a social media fast. I've done this many times. It just comes to a place where there's so much information, there's so much negative information, that I find my devotions are much more applicable and clear when I just take some of the other stuff and set it aside. Some of you might consider getting back to school and getting back on track spiritually, a television fast for 40 days. A television fast. That's something that may be needed for someone tonight. Someone or some teens might want to consider a video game fast. And by the way, parents, some of you might assist them in that fast. Quickly help them fast. But this is something that perhaps during the holidays and during the Christmas break became a little bit of an idol, became a little bit too much, and it's time to set it aside and to seek God. A fast. Now, if you have health concerns about fasting, talk to your doctor. I listed out several things here. Dr. John R. Rice said, the spirit of fasting simply means that one, for the time being, is willing to abstain from the otherwise normal and proper duties or pleasures, that he may give himself wholly to the business of prayer. Fasting is really putting God first when one prays, wanting God more than one wants food, more than one wants sleep, more than one wants fellowship with others, more than one wants to attend to business. It is saying, Lord, I want to put you first. I want to draw closer to you. And so tonight I want to encourage the church family as we purpose for this year, as we endeavor to draw closer to the Lord, that we would become a church that is more greatly in the Word and greatly in prayer. Now to enhance this, I want you to notice on page 47 that I'm encouraging you to consider and to write what type of fast that you would do for the next 40 days. It might help you to tell someone in your connection group, hey, I'm going to fast this way for the next 40 days. Would you pray with me? Would you keep me accountable? That's totally fine to do that and to have a partner. Matter of fact, I've done that myself before with seasons of fasting. And you might have one person that you talk to about that and that you pray about in this area. Now, as we consider this matter of seeking God in Bible reading, prayer, and fasting, I'm going to ask many of you that are going to make the commitment tonight to go ahead and go to lancasterbaptist.org/newyear. And if you're going to make this commitment to Bible study, prayer, and fasting, I want to encourage you for the next 40 days, and I'm just going to ask you to go to that site, register, and I'll send you an email once a week just to kind of encourage you in your spiritual journey. By the way, that's the job of the pastor, is to encourage the flock along the way in their spiritual journey. And there are many other aspects to this that you can read, but I think we've all got the idea of where we're going. We're going to take this approach. SOAP, S stands for? Help me now. S stands for? O stands for? A stands for? And the P stands for? Taking time to make it personal with God. Let me encourage you to register at lancasterbaptist.org. Take a quick look, if you would, there at page 50. You'll see what you're going to have each day before you. I can't think of a more helpful, practical way for all of us to have some time alone with the Lord. Husbands and wives can do this together, but I would encourage you to do it separately. Let the Lord speak to you individually and take time. And teenagers, I want to encourage you to take this and utilize it in your life. Now, we're going to refer back to some things in this book in just a little while, but as we purpose for the year, the very first aspect of the purpose is that we would be a church of Bible reading and prayer. The second purpose I want to share with you tonight revolves around the children of Lancaster Baptist Church, and that would be our Kids City project. There has never been a time in America where more children, due to the isolation, due to the mandates and policies, they have not had school, they have fallen behind academically, many have fallen behind socially. I'll be sharing with you in the upcoming weeks that the rise in depression amongst adolescents, the rise in suicide and attempted suicide among teens is exponential. If there has ever been a time for us to finish this building and throw the doors wide open and say, kids, come on in and have fun and enjoy that game room and hear the preaching and teaching and know that God loves you, if there's ever been a time to get it done, it is now. And we're going to share a few things about this in just a moment as far as where we are, but let's first look at the calendar there. You'll see our fellowship night is coming up on January the first. And as we think about this, you can turn in your book, if you'd like, over to page number 14. Page number 14 in our New Year's book, the Not Ashamed book. And you'll notice there that the fellowship night is coming up January 30th. Once again, I want to encourage everyone tonight to go by the tables, sign up for the fellowship night, and receive your lapel pin, not ashamed. And we want to get everybody ready and praying as we approach our offering time coming up in the month of February. We're going to have an event. We're calling it the Steel Signing Event. We're watching and waiting with respect to all of the shipments and some of the delays that America is experiencing with products. So it may be steel, it may be sheetrock, it may be the floor. I have no idea. It may be a piece of paper, but we're going to go peek into that building and pray over that building together on February the 6th. And then our Kids City offering, of course, is on February the 20th. And so these are some significant dates we want you to place on your calendar and plan to pray, plan to participate. We're asking the Lord to let us cut the ribbon on that building within the next 9 months. How many of you will pray with me that by the time the fall program comes upon us, that we will have a brand new kids building wide open for hundreds of children every Sunday morning to hear the Word of God? Will you pray with me about that? This has been a time coming. We've had engineering changes. We've had delays with COVID. Now we have supply chain delays, all of these things, but we're moving forward and we're trusting God. And how many of you believe that if we can cut the ribbon on a building where most of the work and the prayer and the giving was done during COVID and finish that building and have it paid for, that God will receive great glory in that project? And that's exactly what I'm praying. And tonight, I'm sharing this vision and asking you to pray that this will be the year that the building is completely finished to the glory of God. Now, we're going to share it more with more specificity in the next upcoming weeks where we are with the project. But just tonight, to share briefly with you where we are, the overall project cost is around a $5 million project cost. I don't know if we have that slide or not, but if you want to jot that down, it's a $5 million budget. And as you think about that budget, we have raised to date about $3.5 million. Can we thank the Lord for that right now? Let's thank the Lord for that. $3.5 million has been raised. That means that in order to finish this project and to completely have it paid for, we're going to need between 1.5 and 1.7, depending on the last few months and some change orders that could come, but around $1.5 million to see this project completely finished for the glory of God. And ladies and gentlemen, I believe that we serve a God that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And I told the deacons probably 5 or 7 years ago that as I got to this stage of ministry, this very young stage of ministry that I'm now in, that we would always wait until we had more than half of the funds raised before we started the project, and that we would do our very best to pay for every project going forward in cash. The church is old enough, it's godly enough, we are resourced by our God, and how many of you believe that we would be wise to finish this and get it paid in the process? Amen? And that's what I'm asking the Lord to let us accomplish. And so that's where we're at. I'll give you more about the numbers and some of the process of what's going on out there as we have our Vision Sunday coming up in a few weeks. So these are some things for the children, and let's be in much prayer for the Kids City project. Next, I want you to notice that we have some ministry-wide goals that we're asking the Lord to help us with, some things that I believe are vitally needed. And I want to share those with you very, very quickly. First, I would ask you to pray with me tonight about this ministry-wide goal of planting a new church in the city of Los Angeles. Sometimes, if you're like me, I look out and I see the needs of this state, and my heart is overwhelmed, really. 40 million people, cities of 100,000 without one soul-winning church. We see a lot of times cities that are having churches close, but they're still growing in population. And so I want you to pray that this fall, Lancaster Baptist Church will be able to partner together with a young pastor to get behind this pastor like we have with the Whipplers, and to see a new church like when we established the Los Angeles Baptist Church or the church down in Hollywood, some of these others. We want to see a church raised up for the glory of God. And we're already praying and talking to some folks about this. We've already asked some folks if they'd be involved in giving. There's already been been around $50,000 raised for this project, and we're going to be asking others to get involved. We have some pastor friends who've said, hey, we'll help start the church in Los Angeles. I would ask you to pray with me. If you have ideas or thoughts, you let us know. I've driven around a few different neighborhoods trying to study the need, and we want God to use us to raise up another lighthouse, because how many of you know that Los Angeles is as much a mission field as Finland? It really is. And if you haven't driven through lately, there are millions of people who need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Next, I'd like you to pray with me as we look at some of the ministry-wide goals. Pray with me that we might be able to complete the design effort for a remodeled platform and for a new sound system. This auditorium is now 22 years old, and it is still a state of the art. Really, I've preached in many wonderful auditoriums across America. This auditorium has what I like to call clean lines. It has good line of sight. In other words, none of you can hide unless you're behind one of these cameramen, but then I can still move to see you, you see. That's how that works. There's no poles holding up the balcony. There's tremendous lighting and good air conditioning. But it's time that we do some remodeling of the platform. Oftentimes when there's groups singing up here, it's very difficult to stand. We don't always have enough room. We need to come out just a little bit, and we'd like to do some different things with lighting, color. Our soundboard is 22 years old. Do you know that the soundboard in this church is used 6 days a week? Chapel is conducted for the college, for the school, in this auditorium, day after day after day, large events, conferences, and all of our services. And there's some stuff up in that sound booth that's being held together right now with baling wire. I just pray, Lord, let the sound system get us through another week, another month, and God's been faithful. We have great technicians, but I want to put new equipment into their hands. We want to do some enhancement for our sound ministry, for the music ministry. And so while we will not construct that necessarily this year, we want to get the design going on that project. We'd like to add 100 new pastor's prayer partners. And you'll notice on the calendar of events that we gave you that there will be a meeting coming up for the pastor's prayer partners. That's on page 8, if you turn there very quickly. Page number 8. And it will tell you that on January the 23rd is our next pastor's prayer partner meeting. And if you're not in the pastor's prayer partner ministry, it doesn't take a lot of time, really. Just 4 times a year, I meet with the group. I go over what's coming up next for the church. What are some major prayer requests? What am I preaching about? Where will I be preaching if out of town? And I just covet your prayers. I covet your prayers this very moment as I preach this message. I covet the prayers of our church family, and it's a special group that gathers, and if you'd like to just get to know me a little better and know the heart of the church and things coming up, this is a great ministry. We're asking God for 100 more people to say, I'll pray for my pastor, and we'll send you out an email. Brother Miles is the director of this ministry. He's tremendous at communicating with everybody involved. And Brother Miles, we've been praying for the young lady in Iowa. She's off the ventilator. I wanted to mention that. And sometimes we'll get requests like that, urgent prayer requests. By the way, if you urgently needed prayer, would it mean something to you if 200 real prayer warriors would instantly go to prayer about that? I'll tell you what, it's a great ministry to be involved in. 100 new people, that's what we're asking God for. We're asking the Lord to give us a minimum of 6,000 on Easter Sunday. We've had many more than this before. I think that might be a little less faith, but that's a good baseline as we look going out of COVID and going back into some greater services for the Lord. How many of you will pray that we have at least 6,000 people on Easter? Will you pray that with me? And I believe as we come through this COVID and all of this, we can see many, many more come to Christ, but you pray with me about that, and I would greatly appreciate it. Let's move from there into some of our outreach goals, and you may see some of these as well in the booklet there. I think they're in the order number 2. Some of the outreach goals that we have. First of all, we want to go to every home in the valley 2 times with a gospel message. Every home in the valley 2 times. We want to train 100 new soul winners. Now, Brother Furso said something this morning, and really he'll be contacting many of our new members, but he said there will be a class starting on Saturdays a few weeks from now where he will be teaching people that have never had the privilege of leading someone to Christ how to lead someone to Christ. If you have never led someone to Christ, don't miss that class. That's the lifeblood of Lancaster Baptist Church, is soul winning. We want to keep the main thing the main thing, and we want to encourage everyone to come out on a Saturday or a Thursday night, if that's better for your schedule, and plan to be a part of the soul winning ministry of Lancaster Baptist Church. We have 5 community outreach events. We have 8 SOS breakfasts. Lots of things you can read about there in the realm of outreach. We're also asking the Lord to help us in our adult ministry. We'd like to come back to over 1,000 in the adult connection groups on Wednesday night. We'd like to enroll 150 in continued discipleship this year. We want to graduate at least 100 adults along the line of what Paul said at Rome, establishing people, 100 adults in their faith. We want to conduct 4 core classes. During COVID, we were a little bit off that mark. These are the new member classes where we welcome and help people into the church. These are wonderful times. We want to get back to the schedule of 4 this year. We want to begin a new couples class this year amidst other adult department goals. Next, we want to talk about the bus ministry and just some things here to pray about. We're asking the Lord to let our bus ministry come back to 400 weekly in average attendance. Brother First of all, I think we're right about 200 now, and so we're building back. A lot of the children during COVID had moved away, gotten out of the habit, all these kinds of things. And so our next goal is a minimum of 400 weekly. Now, that doesn't count maybe a big day of 600 or 700, but every week bringing in 400 boys and girls. And these children need the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we're praying that God would help our bus ministry. If you would like to serve in the bus ministry, see Brother Jerry Furso or some of the other staff. They'll direct you. We want you to be a part of serving Christ, and if that's an area that you'd like to help with, children that are from single parent homes sometimes, and sometimes some troubles at home, and I'm going to tell you something, you look into the face of a child as someone is loving them to Jesus, it is so rewarding. What a great ministry. Your pastor's wife, my wife, is sitting right here tonight in church because of a bus captain, an engineer from IBM, who gave every Saturday morning, Brother Thurgood, to knock on doors. Knocked on the door of my wife and brought her to church, and I'm so glad that he did. I encourage you to pray for the bus ministry, love the bus ministry, be a part of it in the new year. And then, of course, we're also asking that we would have from the bus ministry 50 families that would visit the church. The best way to help the bus kids is to lead their mom or dad to Christ. And that's what we're praying for in the new year. We're asking for 20 new bus workers. You might just ride the bus and help with teaching or counseling. You might drive a bus. There are many ways to help teach a class for bus kids. But if you're interested in helping the children, this is an opportunity this year. Let's talk next some about our student ministries. And these are some great opportunities that we have. Let me come back to the children's ministry first. I'm not sure what page you're on there. You might find children's on page 30. Children's ministry, we're asking the Lord in our Sunday school for 100 children to be saved and 50 to be baptized this year. Thank God for our Sunday school workers, and we're looking forward to a great and fruitful year there. Next, we have our student ministries, our youth ministry. We're asking the Lord for 175 teens to be involved in this challenge for giving. It's called the Advanced Teen Offering, and pray for the teenagers as they're already saving and praying so that they can be a part of the Kids City building. We're asking the Lord for 75 teenagers this year who will learn how to share the gospel and who will present the gospel to someone in the Antelope Valley. And these teenagers, we're going to be taking the teenagers with us on Saturdays out soul winning and teaching them how to share their faith. I remember as a 7th grade boy going out on soul winning. And of all places, I went to a place called Hellyer Park. That's where I learned how to be a soul winner. And I'd go to Hellyer Park with our youth group, and I'd just stand in front of grown adults and say, "Hi, my name's Paul Chapel. I'm from United Baptist Church, and we're just out here asking people if they know the Lord, if they know for sure that they're on their way to heaven. Do you know for sure if you're on your way to heaven someday?" And depending on how they'd answer it, I would go into the next scripture. And I believe that teenagers need to learn how to share their faith. There is joy in serving Jesus Christ. And so we're excited for our teenagers in this area. Lots of other things. We're going to be hosting the 2022 Youth Conference this spring. There's a 2-day winter retreat coming up for juniors and seniors in a few weeks. And there will be quarterly parent meetings this year and many, many other things. Next, you You can see some of the single ministry goals, and we're thankful for our singles ministry. They'll be hosting several activities and events, singles conference in October. They're praying to see 75 singles saved in this year. And Brother Fleming is leading that department. And the reason we give you these goals is so that as you pray, when you take that time to pray, you can go through some of these goals and pray for these goals. And pray, God, let our church see 75 single adults get saved. How many of you believe getting saved is a better decision than going to the bar? And prayer can make a difference. And so pray for our singles department in these areas. They want to see 25 single adults graduate from discipleship. Ladies ministry, there's a great amount of things for you. The ladies conference this fall, there will be ministry prayer walks on the campus. There'll be four events called Home, helping our mothers excel for young mothers, ladies growth nights, and many other activities. Our hospitality ministry, we're looking for 20 new friendly people to help welcome folks that are coming in. I met several new members today, several guests today that will be coming back. We want to be the church that's welcoming them, and hospitality ministry is a great way for that. Choir and orchestra has been building back. I think we had 5 or 6 new choir members tonight. Praise God for that. We're asking the Lord for 45 more this year, that God would help us fill up the choir loft and sing glory and praise unto the Lord, as well as 10 new orchestra members. The Korean ministry is praying for 24 salvations and baptisms. Pray for our Korean ministry as they visit 350 Korean homes this year. Spanish ministry, we'll be hosting a spiritual leadership conference next week. They're praying for an average attendance over 800 every week and for 75 to be baptized. Lancaster Baptist School will be conducting 2 student revivals. They'll be conducting student-led prayer meetings. They're looking to improve their classroom technology by utilizing Google Chromebooks and Google Classroom software, and uplifting and enhancing our facilities with lighting, flooring, and shared space theming. Also, upgrading our athletic facilities with new scoreboards and equipment. We're looking to add a press box for the videographer and a new snack shop facility on the football field. These are some things that we're working on and praying for Lancaster Baptist School. We could give many other things, but that's just a little bit of a picture of how to pray for Lancaster Baptist School, spiritually, academically, program-wise. And then let's mention finally West Coast Baptist College. Just some things here. Again, so many things could be said. We're asking the Lord to give us a minimum of 250 freshmen this fall. We're asking the Lord for 2 missions trips for our students this summer. We want to complete the fundraising for the Walther Center, and we want to build a brand new exercise facility in the remaining 2,000 square feet of the Walther Center. We had one gift of $75,000 that came in recently and another that's been pledged. So pray for that project if you would. We'll be telling you more about that as the year progresses along. We want to visit hundreds of churches representing West Coast Baptist College this year. Today we have 5 men that are out preaching in different churches and talking about the college and recruiting students. You pray for them if you would. We'd like to influence over 400 churches in our on-campus ministry through the conference, the youth conference, the basketball tournaments, and in other ways, encouraging and edifying churches and telling young people about the ministry of West Coast Baptist College. And finally, we want to conduct 4 youth summits where we hold youth rallies in different regions around America, influencing teenagers for God and inviting them to West Coast Baptist College. Now, these are not merely activities. These are activities with a purpose in mind. And we're talking tonight about knocking on 164,000 doors. We're talking about building a state-of-the-art multi-million dollar building. We're talking about training teenagers and college students and 6-year-olds and 9-year-olds. We're talking about revival meetings. We're talking tonight about a great work for God. And yet we must purpose tonight and ask the Lord to use and bless this purpose for His glory. I believe one of the characteristics of an unashamed Christian is that they purpose to live for God. But let me share the second aspect with you tonight, and that is passion. God is looking tonight for people who will go forth in great passion. You may not be as young as you once were, but you can still have a holy fire burning within your heart. A heart of passion for the Lord. Now look at the passion of the apostle in verse 14. He says, I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Now I want you to notice here there is an accounted passion. This is an accounting term, the term debtor. It means one who owes another. How many of you say, finally, I understand something in the Bible. I understand being in debt. All right? It's an accounting term. Paul is telling us that his passion was born partly out of this understanding that he owed other people what he had been given. He was bound by this duty. He was under obligation to preach the gospel to everyone possible. The obligation arose from the favor that God had shown to him. Paul determined that if God had favored him with salvation, then he owed it to those around him to tell them of salvation. Oh, tonight, how many of you are thankful that God has favored you with salvation? And I say to you tonight, we are debtors. We are debtors to our community to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. Acts 9 and 15, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. You see, the apostle Paul had a passion. He was a debtor to the Greeks, those that dwelt in Greece. He was a debtor to the barbarians, the Bible says. And he went about to those that that were maybe included under the general name of the Greeks, but not of the cultured sort. He went to the wise, speaking again of those who considered themselves to be men of wisdom, but still were lost without Jesus Christ. He went to the unwise, those who needed to know that true knowledge is found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in those words, barbarians, wise, unwise, Greeks, we can find that everybody needs the gospel of Jesus. Children, bus kids need the gospel. Engineers need the gospel. Drug addicts need the gospel. Everybody needs the gospel. Listen to me tonight. Don't look at someone and think of them as lesser than you. They are exactly like you, a sinner that needs the grace of God. And we owe the gospel message to all of those around us. It was a passion that was accounted for. Martin Lloyd-Jones said, the gospel is open to all. The most respectable sinner has no more claim on it than the worst. Everybody deserves to hear the gospel message. And so this was an accounted passion. The apostle Paul said, I am a debtor. But notice also, it is what I call a poised passion. I see here a man poised for his mission. Notice if you would in verse 15, the Bible says, so as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Paul was preparing for Rome. He was preparing to go to Rome. He says, as much as in me is, I'm ready. I'm ready. And folks, I don't know about you, but I believe and I'm thankful for America's military might. I believe that we need a strong and a ready military. I believe America has enemies tonight in Iran, China, North Korea, just to name a few places. And I'm telling you, we need a military tonight that as much as in them is ready. And sometimes it bothers me to hear generals in the military who are more concerned with changing terms like man and woman, who are more concerned about such silliness than they are about the accuracy of the defense of the United States of America. We don't need to be playing these little cultural games and bowing down to the whims of society. We need to be ready at moment's notice to defend the red, white, and blue. If we're going to pay our tax dollars to support this military, they need to be ready to defend our borders. And Paul said, as much as in me is, I'm ready to bring the gospel to Rome. Brother Whipler, if you cannot say as much as in me is, then don't go to Finland. But if God has compelled you, and with every fiber of your being you want to see people saved there, then you must go, and you should go, and you are a debtor to those in that great land. We must be prepared as much as in me is. If I was a basketball coach and I had five players on the court and there was a sixth man and it was often going to be his turn to come out. I want that guy sitting there, and as much as in him is, he's watching every play. He's watching how the defense is being conducted. He's watching who to box out for a rebound. He's watching who to pass to. He's looking for the weakness on the other team. And as much as in him is, he is ready to go out on that court and to play that game. You don't want somebody that just kind of lollygagging with their arm on the chair next to them, who's winking at their girlfriend, who's goofing around on the bench. Keep him on the bench. You want somebody that as much as in them is, they are ready to get into that game. And we need some men tonight who would say, as much as in me is, I am ready for 2020. I am ready to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, we must be prepared. Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. I am prepared to preach among you and to show the power of the gospel. This is what he was saying. He was passionate about it. He was poised in his preparation, and he was aware of the need that they had. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. And oh, tonight, church family, we must say, God, give to me a holy purpose for living, that I might bear some fruit among the Gentiles. God, give to me a passion so that I can say, I'm not just going out soul winning, getting a donut, running a few errands. No. As much as in me is, I want to see somebody saved. Oh, God, give me the passion again. I love you, dear church. Oh, if you knew. But sometimes good church members can lose their passion. We can just go through the motions. Don't waste 2022. Don't just go through the motions, but pray that the Spirit of the living God would fall fresh on you, that you would have a passion to say, as much as in me is, I'm ready to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, the characteristics of the unashamed, they have a purpose to live for. They have a passion to live with. And notice finally, they have a power to serve in. They have power through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Notice, if you would, in verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Would you say that with me, please? For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. One more time. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation. Now, folks, if the power is up to us physically, we're in trouble. Just about everybody here tonight has some kind of an ailment. Something not just exactly right. I get tickled sometimes when they talk about professional athletes. They'll say, oh, he's got a bruised heel. He's got a little torn ligament in his pinky finger. Those are million-dollar fingers. We understand that. They worry about those things. Folks, tonight, the power is not in us. The power is not in who we know on this earth. The power is not in our education. But there is power, and I can't always explain it. There is power in the gospel of Jesus Christ. If it is only shared, there's power in this message. The gospel. The Bible is very clear that it is the death, burial, and resurrection. It is the power of God, this gospel. It is the dunamis. It is the strength and power of the ministry. It has inherent power. It is a residing power. It is a virtuous power. It is a power that changes lives. Why is the gospel so powerful? It is powerful because its source is God. It is the power of God, this gospel of Jesus Christ. God demonstrates his power when we open it and tell somebody that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died, that he rose again. It may sound simple to you, but there are people in this valley who have never understood clearly who Jesus is nor what he did for them. And when they do, And when a little child hears that God loved them that much, and when someone who's been trying to find satisfaction in all the wrong places realizes that Jesus has paid for their salvation, there's something powerful. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Paul said, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God, you see. There's something powerful about this book. It's quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And when you open this book, and when you quote from this book, miracles can happen. Why aren't we seeing friends saved? We're not opening the book. Why aren't we seeing more fruit? We're not speaking from the book. God taught me this lesson at an early age, and I remember when Terry and I were first married, and we drove out there to the Salton Sea, and we would preach on the weekends for this small group of people there. And as we first met in a little single wide trailer, and then finally we met for a while in a house, and as we would invite people to this house, we would preach the gospel. And there was nothing fancy about my messages. There really wasn't. I just would really just open up some verses from John, try to read. I read J.C. Ryle's commentary, wrote out some notes, stood up and just kind of let it fly and told people about Jesus and what he did for them. Now, I've told you before about the first couple that got saved when I was preaching. I remember preaching that morning on John 3:16, and every one of you know John 3:16. You could preach that. All of you could preach that. Oh, I preach, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, Jesus. And I talked about Jesus, how he is so perfect and wonderful and lovely and kind. I talked about how Jesus came down to us, how he bent down and lowly wrote in the sand when they were accusing the woman in adultery, how he walked into Peter's boat, how he walked into Bethany when Lazarus was dead, how Jesus so humbly and kindly came to us. And I preached about the fact that whoever would believe on Christ and the work of the cross could be saved. I'll never forget, I preached everything I knew about John 3:16. It took about 20 minutes maybe less. I said, let's stand together. It's time for the invitation. We had the one pianist. She could play only one song, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. That was it. And so I sang Just As I Am, and she played Just a Closer Walk with Thee. I was having the time of my life, by the way. Just singing away, just up there leading the singing. I wasn't on any kind of a note. She wasn't even playing the right song, but I was in the ministry serving the Lord. Hey, it's fun to serve Jesus. And I'm just up there doing that, and all of a sudden, Fred and Alice Riley came down to the front. It shocked me. Pastors aren't supposed to say this, but I said to them, what did you come up here for? They said, well, you said that God sent his son and that whoever believes on him can be saved and go to heaven. I remember telling that story at Fred's funeral. A lot of times people say to me, Pastor, that was a sweet funeral. And I always say, it's the way the person lived, and it's the fact that they knew Jesus that made it a sweet funeral. It's not what I say, it's what they decided while they were still alive. That's when I realized, I don't have to be a great orator, but if I'll just have a sincere heart and life, and if I'll just open up the Bible and preach the gospel, that the power is not found in my ability, it's found in this book. Oh, listen, we do not go forth without resources. We have the greatest resource of all in the gospel of Jesus Christ. 1 Thessalonians 1:5, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, that ye know what manner of men we were for your sake. It's powerful because of its source. The source of the gospel is God. It's powerful because of its sufficiency. You see, the Bible says that it is the power of God unto salvation. It is only through the Word of God that someone will be saved. Only the Word of God sufficiently brings the message of salvation. Romans 5 and 6. But when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. There is power enough in the gospel so that all may be saved. And we understand, George Martin said, there is one gospel and it is universal and applicable to all cultures. The gospel is universally applicable because the one great need of all human beings is the same. They all need to be reconciled with the Creator. We don't go to Finland and preach one gospel and the Philippines and preach another gospel and South Dakota and preach another gospel. It's the same gospel. Amen. Folks, you take a man like Brother Rick Martin and pray for Brother Martin's wife, Becky. She's battling with cancer tonight. You take Brother Martin, I believe, from Oklahoma, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct, Brother John? He's from Oklahoma. Just a small, skinny man in stature. He's given his life for 40 years in the Philippines. He'd be the first to tell you there's nothing fancy about him. He doesn't claim to be anything great. Just yielded. And he went to a city, Iloilo, and for weeks the Roman Catholic radio stations would say, stay away from Rick Martin. Stay away from the Baptists. They are a cult. You will go to hell if you go to his church. Not a real great way to start a church. But that small Oklahoma man just kept standing up and preaching the gospel. The death, the burial, and the resurrection. Friends, tens of thousands of people have been saved. 1,000 graduates of their college have started churches in the Philippines. There's no way humanly, there's no scientist that can explain that. There's no business model that can project that. The only way to explain it is the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hence, the future of Lancaster Baptist Church is as bright as the promises of the Word of God. For there is still power in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, there's power in the gospel. Can I say this? There's power for everyone who believes to be saved. Notice what it says in verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To everyone that believeth. Now the invitation, as I understand Scripture, is all inclusive. For God so loved the world that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You study the Scriptures and you see that the Lord Jesus is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's His heart that men and women everywhere would come to know the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And here we see that there is a gift that is given to all of the world. But there is this one restriction. For the Bible says, to everyone that believeth. I cannot force someone to believe, nor can you. But there's power in the gospel to draw men to faith in Jesus Christ. The power of God unto salvation is for those who will believe. 1 Timothy 4:10. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach because we trust in the living God who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe. In other words, the blood that Jesus shed is efficacious for the entire world, but limited to those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God. And what I want to do at this church every Sunday morning is make the best meal I can and make the gospel as understandable as I possibly can and put it down on the lower shelf so that whosoever will may come and be saved. And that's what every Sunday school teacher and every bus captain must do as well, so that everyone can know the gospel and know how to be saved. Religion says attain this. The gospel says it's already obtained. Religion says attempt this. The gospel says accept. Religion says try. The gospel says trust. Religion says do. The gospel says done. Listen, our message is simply this. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Jesus, in speaking to Peter, said, Peter, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The power then is from the very word of God. No ordinance will stop the church. No mandate will stop the church. No backslidden Christian will stop the church. No gossip will stop the church. No hate will stop the church. Satan will not stop the church. Jesus has promised, I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Folks, we've got a great year ahead of us. I don't know the twists and turns this year may take, but I know that He's already there. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He's already there. And He wants to lead us through this year. And He's looking for some people who would say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed to take His hand. I have a purpose to live for. It's heavenly. I have a passion to live with as much as in me is, Lord. I want to tell others about You. And I have a power that's not of me. It's of You. It's of Your word. And I will go forth with this mighty sword, and I will trust God to bring the victory. This is what it means to not be ashamed. To live with purpose, to live with passion, and to live according to the power of God in your life. This is what it means to be a Christian that is not ashamed.